business means you have to look at the business, you think of how it is taking you, and then you look at the where you can go after that.
Tax incentives are sort of sweeteners.
Hello, welcome to The Business Show. My name is Viola. Here now are weekly highlights of major business stories that made the news locally and internationally.
UDB to reduce its interest rates to 8% in the next 2 years. Insurgency in South Sudan. Businesses slow as traders strike. Plans underway to reduce air travel charges in the East African community. Cybercrime affecting 79% of business operations in South Africa, Kenya, and Zimbabwe.
Once again, welcome to the show. Now, the cardinal objective of tax incentives is to attract investment, especially in developing countries. However, this seems to be affecting Uganda's revenue collection, in turn affecting development. On Views from the Top this week, we speak to the country director, Siatini Uganda.
Uganda as a country has been providing tax incentives to investors, both foreign direct investors and also Ugandan investors. Tax incentives are sort of sweeteners to attract investments in the country and also to attract investments in certain sectors. For example, priority sectors like agro processing, manufacturing, and they are in forms of exemptions from VAT, for example, from income tax, and sometimes some FDIs haven't been paying any corporation taxes at all, and they also vary from some companies have been given a tax holiday of 20 to 25 years, companies like Bidco owe taxes for 25 years. Others have been exempted to pay income tax, and others VAT. So, and the whole purpose has been to attract investors to be able to grow the economy, to increase exports, to create jobs, and also to contribute to revenue mobilization to pay more taxes. What's happening in Uganda is that the list of sectors which are being exempted from paying taxes are increasing almost every year. You can ask whether really the tax incentives are delivering on those promises, promises of creating employment, promises of growing the economy. It's so difficult to really gauge how much and how far the tax incentive agenda has helped Uganda to deliver on those promises, because there are no clear cost benefit analysis which government has put in place to show really whether government is getting value for money. The conditionalities for companies to access incentives are clear in a number of tax laws in the investment code. For example, companies to benefit from tax incentives and tax holidays, they need, for example, to be investing in a priority sector, need to have a minimum capital investment, need to employ, for example, a minimum of 60% of citizens. They need to be exporting around 60% of their products. They are supposed also to be sourcing locally. They are also supposed to have brought in technology or upgraded our indigenous technology. So the parameters are clear. But then when it comes to following up, to monitor whether the companies which are getting tax incentive are adhering to those conditionalities, it becomes a problem, you know. So it's so difficult to say whether we are really getting value for money. Because tax incentives means that government is foregoing a lot of resources which would have been used to support the budget, be put in other budget areas like social services. So I think that it's important that government puts in place monitoring mechanisms to see whether we get value for money for the tax incentives provided. For me, that's really, really critical. Do we need to rethink this strategy? Yes, we need to rethink the strategy. We need to rethink in the post-COVID era. We need to rethink how the role of the private sector broadly in the economy, the role of investments, especially foreign investments, whether they are adding money, adding value or not. But I think what's really clear is that when it comes to the private sector generally and FDI, government has to regulate in public interest. We see investors displacing people, destroying the environment. You know, in fact, investments have come to be associated with human rights abuses. And on top of that, then government gives them tax incentives. So I think it's really, really important that government regulates the FDI, and not just FDI, but also the investments. And government should direct investments where they add value, ensure that they are providing decent jobs, not just jobs, decent jobs. And I think the Uganda Investment Authority should also not promote Uganda as a destination where there is cheap labor. I think that's not really good. And I think government should also put address a number of issues so that Uganda can be able to attract investors, investments which they call greenfield, long-term investments, instead of footloose investors who come here, benefit from the tax incentives, and then the following day they go away. We have investments who are moving out all the time. There is a problem. So we need investments which can be able to promote backward and forward linkages between, for example, agricultural production, manufacturing, then export, you know. So, and in order to do that, government needs to put in place a number of things, not just to dish out tax incentives. In order to attract greenfield investments, for example, we need very good infrastructure. We are landlocked, other people say we are land-linked, which is okay. But to attract investors, we need to have very good infrastructure. We need to have a railway line which links us to the port so that, you know, investors can be able to move their products to the port. We need to work on the issue of energy. Our electricity is so, the electricity tariffs are so high, you know. The issues around access to finance, our finances is so high. the issue around political stability. You know, we can't get serious investors when investors are moving out every 5 years when we are holding elections. So there are so many other issues beyond giving tax incentives, which needs to be put in place. And we also need to ensure that the investments adding value, you know, they are not trampling over people's human rights. And we need also to look at the bigger picture around the economy. If the economy is contracting, then investors won't be able to come because the market is small, you know, unless we are attracting resource-seeking investors who want to extract the gold, extract minerals, and after they have exhausted them, they go away and they take the minerals in the raw form. So as we move forward, I think it's very, very important that we rethink, as Ugandans, what we need from investors, because investment is just a tool to help us to go where we want. So we need to have a clear direction, where we want to go and what we want to achieve. If we want to create employment, revive the economy, increase production and productivity, then we need to change our policy framework to be able to address those challenges. Tax incentives affects domestic revenue mobilization because government is foregoing those resources. In fact, government pays, you know, when government says BIDCO shouldn't pay their taxes, it's government which pays. And at the end of the day, it isn't government which is paying, it's we, the taxpayers. The burden increases on us as taxpayers. So we need to make sure that there is value for money. That if I'm to subsidize an FDI, you know, then I want to see Ugandans getting decent jobs. I want to see that FDI sourcing locally, stimulating production and productivity. I want to see increased exports. So we need to see certain things from the investors if we are to subsidize their operations here. Had a number of challenges, border closures, we had trade wars, and I think as we move forward, you know, to look at the post-COVID economic recovery, a regional approach is critical. We need to move together as a region. We need to trade with each other, and we need to look at issues around investment together, because today we fear that there would be problems around the race to the bottom. Because when you look at already, our tax incentives, the parameters are different. Uganda will provide a tax incentive of 20 years and sometimes 25 years. Rwanda provides 5 to 7 years, you know? And this has the potential of Uganda attracting investors more from Rwanda. And if we look at that, then we see a competition within the region to attract investments, which isn't good for the region. So it's important that we have a common investment model, maybe agreement model treaty on how we are going to treat investors, so that we also market the region as a single destination.
Surely, it's an area that government needs to rethink to boost revenue collection while increasing investment. You're watching The Business Show. Time now for a quick break.